Welcome everyone. Thank you all for joining us on this wintry Wednesday evening. We're going to give everyone a couple of minutes to get in to the webinar with us. Welcome everyone. Lots of people joining us this evening. Happy to see you all here with us. Just gonna give everyone another 30 seconds or so to get logged in. Looks like we have folks from all over the state and country. Thanks so much for joining us on this first Wednesday. Looks like we have just a couple more people coming in. Welcome. Okay. Let's go ahead and get started. My name is Rebecca Ramsey. I'm the Executive Director of Swan Valley Connections. And Swan Valley Connections is a collaborative conservation and education nonprofit organization that is located in the heart of the Crown of the Continent ecosystem up here in Northwest Montana. And our mission is to inspire conservation and expand stewardship of the Swan Valley. And we do that through a number of different programs including things that we do with private landowners, with state and federal agencies in research and monitoring activities, and most especially by providing educational opportunities to people of all ages, whether that's through our Master Naturalist programs, our K-12 programs, our college programs, or a community program like this one that we host on the first Wednesday of every month. All of our programs are recorded and posted to our website, so you'll be able to view this and our other programs that we host on the first Wednesday of every month there, and that website is www.swanvalleyconnections.org. And we are really grateful to host one of our advisors to the board of Swan Valley Connections, Métis writer and storyteller Chris Latrey, also a fabulous poet and published writer and great human being. So without further ado, Chris, welcome, and we'll let you take it away. And just for everybody in the audience, if you have questions throughout Chris's presentation tonight, go ahead and type those into the Q&A box that you should see at the bottom of your screen. And we will come back and get all of those questions at the end of the program. I will be able to read those to Chris so he doesn't have to try to field those throughout his presentation. So again, just type those in the Q&A and we'll get those answered at the end of the program. Chris, thanks again so much for being here with us tonight. Take it away.
All right. Thank you, Rebecca. Thank you, Swan Valley Connections. Thank you, Humanities Montana, who participate in these presentations I do, the things I do, as well as what a bunch of other people do. They help sponsor these events. So thank you to everybody who has taken the time tonight. I don't know what it's like where you are, but it's been snowing all day here. And it's kind of a rare time when I'm happy to be doing this online and not stranded in a ditch somewhere between here and Condon, Montana. So we're going to talk about the Métis buffalo hunters of the Northern Plains and how that relates to who we are as the Little Shell Tribe of Chippewa Indians, who I am as a member of the Little Shell Tribe. I always like to establish who I'm not when I first start these things, because while we deal with a lot of historical information, I'm not an academic. I didn't go to school anywhere. I have a high school education. I'm not a historian. I'm a storyteller, And, you know, along those lines is kind of digging into things maybe behind, you know, behind the scenes stuff that maybe academia doesn't get to. You know, I'd rather talk to an elder than I would sit in a classroom. And that's kind of how I've chosen to approach learning the story of my people, who I come from. And that was the story I was chasing when I met Nicholas Vrooman about a decade ago. And Nicholas Vrooman wrote "The Whole Country Was One Robe, the Little Shell Tribes of America." That's this big book, which you can't get anymore. It's like $1,000 online. I've heard people tell me, went out of print. The tribe's trying to get it printed, reprinted. And what it was is, you know, in the, like around 2010, the state of Montana gave every tribe in the state a certain amount of money to develop their written history. And Nicholas, who was a folklorist, and he worked, you know, he came to Montana and worked in the on the Mannix Ranch as a cowboy, and met his first Little Shell member, and then went on to be a folklorist in the Turtle Mountain Reservation in North Dakota, which we are directly tied to. So Vrooman was a guy with a doctorate in history who did an enormous amount of work that enabled us to get our federal recognition, which we would have not gotten without his efforts. So I always make a point when I talk about what I'm doing and share information that, you know, we talk about standing on the shoulders of giants. Nicholas Vrooman is the giant on which everything that I am telling you is stacked on. And that means, you know, Nicholas Vrooman was able to gather stories from elders who are no longer with us. So everything I do here is a tribute, not just to the Little Shell, but to the work of people like Nicholas Vrooman, and Nicholas in particular. Who I am, and definitely as a result of interacting with Nicholas, is I became an enrolled member of the Little Shell Tribe. And the story I was chasing when I met Nicholas was who I am, coming from the family that I grew up with, always being told that on the one hand that we were Chippewa, but my dad denied that relationship, denied that we were related to any of the other Latres around the state. And that just wasn't true. I grew up in the middle of what we call the Métis archipelago, being all the little communities that the Métis people scattered to over the course of about 100 years. And I didn't even know it. And you know, I'll talk a little bit more about that as this, you know, presentation goes on. And I do these things because, you know, with Nicholas gone, his philosophy was that anytime anybody asked him to do anything, he said yes. And, you know, in his case, it was because he was still working to help us get our federal recognition. Now that we have that, our story still needs to be heard. And I feel an obligation to kind of carry that torch that Nicholas carried for us for so long. And I'm not alone in this. There's a number of us in the tribe that Nicholas directly influenced. And we have all taken that on ourselves to kind of carry forward all the work that he did. And as a storyteller, this book in manuscript form is now in the hands of my publisher. It's called Becoming Little Shell, and it'll be out in about a year. This is the culmination of all that work. So thank you, Nicholas, for all of that. The thing about us, and the reason that nobody really knew who the Little Shell were, or nobody has ever heard the word Métis, you know, nobody knows this stuff. There's a lot of talk in America right now about how we teach history. And the simple fact is that we do a terrible job of teaching anything other than this grand vision that America has always been this shining light in the world. And that's simply not true. And the fact that nobody knows who the Métis are, or knows who the Little Shell are, or have been, is the direct result of this failure to teach the darker sides of our American history, which make us as much who we are as the good stuff. And I think a lot of our difficulties in getting along with each other is the trauma that anybody has of carrying all this buried knowledge and buried emotional weight passed from generation to generation. You know, it was a choice. And Nicholas told me that, you know, that the slide here says there's a room for a dozen professional historians to do a lifetime of work here in like the Northern Plains and Montana and, you know, from like the Red River, which connects, is the border between Minnesota and North Dakota. A dozen professional historians could work their, devote their lives to uncovering the history of these regions and never bump into each other. And, you know, and that's hopefully changing. I like to start out with 574. And what that is 2 years ago, December 19th, 2019, the then President Trump signed into law the spending bill that financed the entire United States military. Part of that was a rider that enabled the Little Shell tribe to become the 574th federally recognized tribe in the United States. And, you know, that seems like a big number. It's not. There's a couple hundred who are still trying to get recognized. And that says nothing to the hundreds of tribes that were eliminated by colonialism before we even arrived at what we can look at today as the existing tribes. So we became 574th, like I said, on December 19th, 2019. This photograph is from our federal recognition celebration in Great Falls, which was January 25th, 2020. And you see this big room full of people. I mean, and it was spectacular that, you know, there were so many Little Shell people, but also so many people I knew from the Blackfeet Reservation and from the Flathead Reservation. And all of the tribes were there representing small delegations to honor us into the community of these federally recognized tribes. But what struck me, you know, is just how interconnected we are with all the tribes and how all the tribes are related to and connected to each other. To the extent that anybody who says they are a full blood anything, it's not true. Nobody's full blood anything. You know, my favorite quote is from my Blackfeet friend, who says the only way we're ever going to get a full blood, find any more full blood Indians is if we find Indians on the moon or some shit. Because it's true. We're all interrelated. We all interacted with settlers moving west. We all married into and created communities between tribes and among tribes. And that is tradition. And there are so many things now that we tend to overlook that tries to separate us from that tradition. So this celebration of all these different people was such a wonderful reminder that this is how it's always been and how it can be if we can just figure out a way to get along a little better. And this is Gerald Gray, Chairman Gerald Gray, who is the chairman of the Little Shell Tribe. And it was just a spectacular moment. And I just like to start there. What does federal recognition mean? Well, I think I tend to go off on tangents when we talk about that. I'm just going to throw this out there that I do can answer those questions. And maybe that is something that if we have time, we can talk about what it means to be a federally recognized tribe. The main argument I like to make is that I don't get caught up in the idea that the United States gave us anything. We already had it. We already knew who we were. My view of federal recognition is the United States finally deciding, you know what, we screwed up. We're admitting the mistake we made. And yeah, we were wrong all along. And we are returning to you something we took that we never had the right to take. So I don't feel any gratitude really towards the federal government for doing that, other than, you know, kind of a grudging side eye. Well, it's about freaking time is kind of how I view it. So the Métis, who are the Métis? Who are the Métis people? Well, this is how I imagine myself now. Once I realized I was never going to be an elf when I was a kid reading Tolkien novels, when I learned about who the Métis people are, this is how I imagine myself now when I'm prowling around on the riverbank. That kind of you see a guy with native features wearing that capot, the blanket jacket with the Hudson Bay Company, trading company stripes on it, which we now know for you Pendleton fans is the Glacier Park pattern on their fantastic blankets. That's the Hudson Bay. And that's a large part of recognizing who the Métis people are. these are some, you know, from some of our famous Western authors, like, or artists like Frederick Remington and Charles Russell. We see these, and they're often referred to as breeds or half breeds, because that's how we have been referred to, you know, for as long as we've existed as a culture. Again, the striped robe, blanket, jacket, coat things. Here's a great one from Charlie Russell. This is probably my favorite, even though it's just a sketched illustration, because you see the moccasins and he's got his Métis sash and a rifle, and you can tell the shirt he's wearing has got some embroidery on it, probably beads, and he's smoking a pipe passed down to us from the voyageurs who came west along the river systems from the Great Lakes to the Red River Valley and were a large part of creating this culture that we became. So this is like the ultimate Métis man as depicted by Charlie Russell, who was around Métis. You know, Charlie Russell spent his ill-fated cowboy days like around the Lewistown area. And that's Métis territory. And he lived in Great Falls. Our headquarters are in Great Falls. So we were there. How did we get forgotten? That's what we're going to talk about. So Métis is a French word that essentially means mixed blood. If you see it with a small m, we're talking about the language, you know, the French language referring to mixed blood person. But if we have a capital M for Métis, we're talking about a specific culture that, you know, they're you know, in Canada right now, they're having some disagreements over who is Métis and who isn't, just like, it's just that identity politics garbage that we have in the United States. For our purposes, for the purposes of the little shell, for the purposes of this particular discussion, we're talking about the Métis culture that came out of the Red River Valley, which is part of the Hudson Bay drainage. So the Red River Valley, like I said, the Red River that flows into Hudson Bay and from the United States side defines the border of Minnesota and North Dakota. And we were this mixed race of European, mostly French men coming here, moving west, trading furs, and marrying into indigenous tribes, indigenous women, primarily, I'll call them Chippewa, because that's how we identify our tribe, but Chippewa, Ojibwe, either one, it's the same. And there's some Cree intermarriage. There were also Scottish and Welsh men who worked for the Hudson Bay Company and who worked for the Northwest Company, all of these trading concerns that tried to, you know, monopolize the fur trade in that region. We are the direct result of that coming together of these multiple cultures and became one specifically unique of our own that combined kind of the best parts of these cultures into one. We ultimately defined our own language, which is called Michif. And you'll sometimes see Métis people called Michif people. So Michif becomes a word for our people, just interchangeable with Métis. And what Michif was originally a trade language. So it was a lot of French and some Welsh Gaelic nouns with a whole bunch of indigenous language verbs, primarily again, Chippewa and some Cree, and you know, really leaning heavily on whichever region this particular form of the language would develop based on what Indians lived around that area. We invented what's called the Red River carts, and we're gonna talk about that quite a bit, which most historians identify as the first instance of wheel use on the Northern Plains by indigenous people. And one of the arguments that you know, the Europeans of the day would say is that, you know, you guys are so primitive that you don't even use the wheel. Well, we didn't have to. When we were primarily around the Great Lakes and all those river systems, we invented the birch bark canoe, which remains a marvel of technology. That's how we traveled. We used lakes and rivers. We didn't need roads because there was no way to get a road through those forests. Once we moved out onto the plains off the river systems, we recognized that there needed to be a better way to travel. And that's when Métis people, in the early, like 1803, invented the Red River cart to travel across the plains. And generally, in this part of the country, when you hear historical references like, oh, French trappers did this, or this guy was a French Canadian, like 80, 90% of the time, you're talking about a Métis person. Because while the French and the European factors working in these trading posts and these forts were certainly in control, they weren't the ones who were going out into the bush and doing the things. The Métis people were. First, it was the Indians. And then as the Métis culture grew, it was primarily Métis going up and down the river valleys and east, west, north, south, were out everywhere. So, you know, it was Métis people that we typically identify as French trappers and French Canadians, because it was not long before if you could get away and pass as a white guy or a Frenchman, you did that. Because despite there being a glorious 50 to 100 year people where it was awesome to be Métis, it didn't take long for that to change. And it all starts back, you know, Hudson's Bay Company in what is now Canada in 1670, when they get a charter from Prince Rupert in England and create what's called Rupert's Land, which we see here on this map. It's a third of what is now Canada, and it extended down into the United States as well. 1.5 million square miles is what this land represented. And it was the entire drainage for any river, creek, whatever that drained into Hudson's Bay right here. And they ran it like a country. I mean, it was essentially their own country. And, you know, it was largely the result of the fur trade that started farther east and moved west across the Great Lakes. And these guys recognized that there was a tons of wealth to be earned trapping animals in this entire region. And the Hudson's Bay Company took control of that. This is like the crossing the Red River at the very upper, I guess it would be the northwest corner of Minnesota, northeast corner of North Dakota, crossing the Red River. And all of the traffic that went up and down that river, and then east to west on the Pembina River. This is the Red River settlement, probably about 1810 or so, between 1800 and 1820. And what this shows is kind of you're seeing the transition from traditional teepees and lodges people living in to this palisaded fort with actual houses and things in there. So it was this overlap where within even single families, you would have branches of the family who still chose to live as indigenous people traditionally in teepees and lodges versus others who decided, you know what, I'm going to open a store or I'm going to be a businessman. And they would have a normal house inside these walled communities. So it was this overlay of just, again, the combination of cultures. And we see coming into the fort in the foreground there, this train of, those are Red River carts, two-wheeled carts that could be pulled by a horse or pulled by oxen. And they could carry 900 pounds at a clip. So where were they going with these Red River carts? Here's a photograph of some guys taking five among their Red River carts. And here's a train of them. So they were used for a number of things. So they were used for freight to carry all kinds of goods, north, south, east, west, but mostly for the purposes of how the Métis really consolidated our power, for lack of a better term, was as buffalo hunters. We were going out into the central, the western plains of North Dakota and on into Montana to hunt buffalo. This is just a picture I took a couple of years ago just out on the bison range, just because I think buffalo are cool. And, you know, we talk a lot about, that's one of the things that we do talk about in history of the United States is what happened with the buffalo. And everybody knows how they were nearly driven extinct and how they were such a key part of indigenous culture, indigenous plains culture. But it was part of the Métis culture too. So I love this little map that I found out it's the inside pages of a children's book in Canada. And we see, like, here's the Red River and here's the Pembina River. And right here was, or here's the Pembina River, I'm sorry. right here is the, what, there's still a town there, Pembinet, but in the early, in the mid 1800s, it was the most populated trading post in this particular region. And here we have an encampment of Métis people, and we see the carts lying in a circle to protect the lodges and teepees inside them. And these arrows show where they kind of move to first gather here and then travel out into the plains. And here we see all these buffalo. And so that's how it started. We started moving west and south as the buffalo, who were originally everywhere, were beginning to contract as far as where you could find the big herds. And that started in the early 1800s. So we were hunting buffalo by out in well into Montana by the 1820s. But we have these popular images of what that looked like. So this is a Russell piece, and it, and in parts of the country it did. You know, we have Indians on horseback with bows and arrows hunting buffalo. You know, and that happened, you know, farther south of the northern plains, you know, as long as there were buffalo. And as the herd started to die out, there was a clash of the traditional southern plains Indians, or even like the Lakota people who were pushed out of, you know, where we came from, like Minnesota, were driven out into the plains prior to us even existing as a specific culture of our own. Here's another Russell one of kind of the standard idea we have. And as much as Russell did a great job of capturing that period in history, he also did a great job of kind of in the popular consciousness, making everybody think that this is the only way an Indian appears. Like we should all look like extras from Dances of Wolves or something. And that's just not how it was. Here's this other Russell image, which I don't know if you can see, if my big mug on the right here is blocking a bit off in the corner here. This painting is called Attack on the Red River Carts. So over here, we can see some Red River carts because this happened. There was clashes on the plains between the Métis and the more traditional, the Blackfeet or the Lakota or the Northern Cheyenne. Anybody who ventured out into these areas that we were all trying to gain sustenance from, there was conflict for sure. And here's Russell, you know, making an example of that in this painting. But there's also tons of art that shows what it was like from the Métis perspective as buffalo hunters. And this is a great one from Paul Kane, who lived in the Turtle Mountains for a number of years and did all kinds of gorgeous paintings that depicted what life was like across, you know, what we now call the Medicine Line, you know, the border with Canada. So this from 1846, you can see guys on these horses that look like Europeans, but then you also see Indians in more traditional clothing, which was part of our community also. Like there's this great image that Nicholas Roman described to me of three guys standing together like on a hilltop. And I think it's a Paul Kane painting as well. One guy looks like a European based on what he's dressed. Another guy is wearing kind of the mix, like the Charlie Russell illustration I showed earlier, of where he's got maybe European pants on and a European style shirt that's heavily embroidered in the indigenous fashion. And maybe he's got a European hat on and he's smoking a pipe. And then the third guy looks like a Charles Russell Indian with, you know, the beaded chest plate and buckskin pants and moccasins and stuff. And the realization that Ruin came to is like, these aren't three people representing different cultures. This is a family. These are three brothers, if we want to think of it the way we look now, because as all of these different fashions and ways to express ourselves through clothing were coming from someplace else, we started adopting those too, just like we do in our modern families, where you look at these family photos from Christmas or whatever, and you've got the goth kid sitting next to the preppy, and dad looks like he just rode in off the range with his cowboy hat and stuff. And mom, you know, is expressing herself with a dress from, you know, New York or whatever. We all gravitate towards these different expressions of adornment through jewelry and clothing and every accessory with bags and the Métis sash and all these things. We did that too. That's not a modern phenomenon. That's been happening as long as people have interacted with each other. And we were big, that's a big part of defining who the Métis were, was this conglomeration of all of these different influences. And we took that onto the plains with us. Here's another great illustration. Now we see a guy, looks like he's got a rifle there that he's hunting the buffalo with. Or these guys, you know, again, there's a very European slash indigenous contrast among the guys who are obviously working together on this hunt. Another guy, this guy looks like he could have, you know, taken a train from Paris out into the northern plains to go hunt buffalo. This is who we are. 30 years ago, before I turned gray and got fat, this could have been me, right? Here's the same picture again. This is my favorite. Because this picture, again, I'm pretty sure it's a Paul Kane one, of what a Métis buffalo hunting party out on the plains looked like. Because we would go out from the Red River Valley different times of the year. Because you go earlier in the year, like in the springtime, and you, for purposes of meat, but you go out in winter because that's when you're going to get the most luxuriant robes. So depending on what we were going to be trading, that would be when we would go out to hunt. And we would hunt, we would move our entire families out there. We would take cattle with us, you know, out in these big trains of anywhere from 100 to 2,000 Red River carts, and set up essentially little towns that we would use as a base to hunt buffalo from. Because again, in the conversation about how Indigenous people used buffalo, we tend to think of it as like for our personal grocery store, which was that. But for us, it became our entire economy, because we were trading what we could reproduce, what we could manufacture from the buffalo to trade for the other things we need. So pemmican, which is kind of like a jerky, bison jerky mixed with fruit like service berries or choke cherries, kind of held together with fat. Think of like a Cliff Bar, like a chunk of food, but it's mostly fat with some stuff in it. There's probably a little, you know, buffalo shit in there sometimes too, because it wasn't like industrial kitchens when we're putting this stuff together. But that was a huge part of the economy of the Northern Plains, to the point where the trading companies, like the Northwest Company, who was the big kind of rival to the Hudson's Bay Company, they fought what they are called the pemmican wars over who had access to Métis pemmican, because it had a high caloric hit to keep you on your feet when you're out traveling. You know, they didn't have convenience stores they could stop off for burritos and stuff. So they ate pemmican. You could carry a lot of it without a whole lot of weight. On top of that, you know, we're getting buffalo hides that could be either used by ourselves or turned into buffalo robes or buffalo hats or all the things that we think of that those hides could be turned into. As the herd started dying out, we gathered up bones because there was a huge trade in bison bones. So it was more than just, you know, the Indian used every part of the buffalo. Well, we did that too, but we also used every part of the buffalo to trade for cooking pots and to trade for rifles and ammunition. So it was more than just what we needed for our personal use. We used that, it was an industry. Here's a picture of a train of Red River carts headed out somewhere. This doesn't look to me like a buffalo one. This is probably like a freight operation, but you get the idea of stringing these things together. Here's an actual photograph of what that would, you know, that contrasted against that painting. You know, every teepee's got its Red River cart parked next to it. We also spread Catholicism as a result of going out into the plains. Because remember, you know, by the 1840s, 1850s, 1860s, as we're doing this, there's a lot of settlers coming out too. And Catholicism was always a big part of who the Métis people were. Because when these relationships began between European men and Indigenous women, the first thing that the European man would do as he became head of the household is he would insist that his wives adopt Catholicism, which they kind of did. The thing is for the first few decades, there weren't any missionaries there. So it became a lived religion, like a very folk version of Catholicism, where these Indigenous women took the power that they saw in the religion of the Europeans, the Catholicism, and they mixed it with their own Indigenous folklore and beliefs. Because the idea was, this is a hard life. And anywhere that we can get spiritual power, we're going to take that. We don't care so much about your idea of the one God. We're just going to use that along with what we're already doing. And that went on for decades. But it wasn't until missionaries came and started imposing rules on the European side of these relationships, forcing these marriages to either be remade, vows taken under the auspices of the Catholic Church, as opposed to the of the country relationships that happened before there were priests, that's when things really started to unravel. But there were priests who would go out. There was always at least one on these long trains out to hunt buffalo, and it enabled them to kind of consolidate their power with the people they were traveling with, as well as spread their word out into other parts of the landscape without the risk that they faced when they would go out in their small groups alone. So they had, these big convoys of Métis people to protect them. And then when they would stop somewhere, whoever was already there or nearby, they would preach to. An example of that, this is a drawing or an illustration from one De Smet. The stories is that Father De Smet brought Catholicism to the savages in the Bitterroot Valley, which, that was the first mission. But, Métis had already been up and down that valley for close to 100 years. And they were already talking about Catholic folklore, and all of the Indians in that area knew about the Black Robes before De Smet ever got there. He was the third try. He was the third delegation of people who went to St. Louis to try and bring somebody back to help them. But this illustration is by one of the members of De Smet's entourage, a guy named Nicholas Point, I think. But what I love about this picture is this little Easter egg right in the middle, where you see a Red River cart. A guy named Gabriel Prudhomme was the guy who brought De Smet up from, basically by Pocatello, Idaho, is where, De Smet came west and then came up from the south. This guy, Gabriel Prudhomme, was the guy who guided him there. And there were a number of Métis in that particular entourage that ended up in what's now Stevensville, Montana. I just love that. That's one of the things that Nicholas Point liked to bring out, illustrations like this, and look for these little Easter eggs of the Red River cart showing up. Because if you saw a Red River cart, you were looking at Métis people. This is a photo I took from the top of Mount Sentinel in Missoula, which has the big M on it. And this is Hellgate Canyon, which was named by Métis travelers who passed through this pass looking down on East Missoula here. The Gates of Hell, they called it, which they named it in Michif, because the Blackfeet preyed on travelers passing through there. And it was a tough place to survive, but it was used by everybody. It was used by, tribes to the west who would go east to hunt buffalo for hundreds of years. And now when we look at like I-90 and Highway 93, all of these highways that we use were built on the cart tracks of the Red River carts that Métis people used to trade with all of these people back and forth and up and down. When John Mullen wanted to build the Mullen Road, he hired Métis guides to take him along their cart trails because he knew that was going to be the best route. So the Mullen Road laid almost exclusively on top of Red River cart tracks. Now there's a ton of big events that kind of comprise what all this means to the Little Shell people. I talked about the Pemmican Wars. cattle. It was Métis people who went to St. Louis in 1815 and brought cattle back to the Northern Plains. So we all think of, like, you know, the Texas cattle drives coming up, you know, as being the way that cattle got into our part of the country. But we already had hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of cattle long before anybody in Texas got an idea to come north with their longhorns. The Stevens Expedition of 1853 played a large role in kind of moving what tribes were going to live where. And as a part of that series of negotiations, one of which was the Hellgate Treaty of 1855, which people here in Missoula, you know, are live in the shadow of, because that's what created the Flathead Reservation and moved all the Salish people out of the Bitterroot Valley and moved them, took their land and put them north of their traditional lands. Treaty of Old Crossing, 1863. There's just a bunch of significant treaties and interactions with the federal government that kind of created the Little Shell Tribe. And if we have time, I'll go back and talk about some of these. But it wasn't just any one thing. It was a number of significant events that happened in the Northern Plains that created what became the Landless Indians for 156 years. But I want to talk about Chief Little Shell, because that's where we get our name from, is this particular Chief Little Shell, which was not his name. Little Shell was a hereditary title, and he was the third. His name was, his given name was Ayabwewitung, which means he who rests on the way. His father was also called Little Shell, and his grandfather was Little Shell, and they were the leaders of the Pembina Band for almost about 100 years. They were hereditary chiefs, which has a different meaning than what we think of Indian chiefs as any of our leaders were, like, you know, it's my way or the highway. These guys had to negotiate with their people because no one was obligated to follow them. So they had to be negotiators and inspiring leaders. They had to earn the respect of their followers to have people do what they thought was right. So it was a totally different type of leadership from what the United States wanted from the tribes when they tried to get these treaties signed. Is they wanted somebody to be the one guy that they could talk to, and it just didn't work that way. The Little Shell was the third hereditary chief and the one who was in charge when a lot of things just really started to unravel. So when he takes over in 1872, this is pretty much what the territory of the Pembina Indians were, which were all that mixture of Chippewa and Cree and Métis living in the kind of upper right-hand corner of this map here that's in red. Whoops. So this is like the 1870s. By then, it probably shrunk. This is at the height of their power, which, you know, for 50 years, they were the power in the Northern Plains, because you roll out into the plains with 1,000 carts and nobody can mess with you. And you come back with those carts loaded with all of these trade goods and you become quite wealthy. And everybody did well in that period. The Europeans establishing the trading posts did well. The indigenous people did well. Everybody was doing very well, but it didn't last. By the time Little Shell got an Indian reservation, in 1882, he went from this to this. So all of this land was what was traditional Pembina. And they became the Turtle Mountain Chippewa with initially 450,000 acres. 2 years later, it was reduced to 45,000. And all of these other little reservations were set up for different tribes who were also in the area. But it was a huge land grab. And Little Shell, who I feel like should be as well known to people as, you know, Sitting Bull and Crazy Horse, as a leader who in desperate times managed to retain some land for his people and a tradition. And you know, it didn't end well, but he devoted his life to it. And these are critical events that nobody knows about. at the time, you know, 1880s, when things are really collapsing, this is what a Métis home would look like. This could be anywhere. This could be in Livingston, Montana, which was founded by Métis people. This could be along the Milk River, anywhere between, you know, North Dakota, you know, once the milk gets into Montana, it could be anywhere along the Milk River. Often you will see, you know, these photographs or even Russell paintings of the brave homesteaders and their cabins. Well, often as not, those cabins belong to Métis people who were driven out. And then the cabins were taken by white settlers, just like happened on the East Coast with the Cherokee at the, you know, after the Trail of Tears. You know, they're headed west, and there's a white family with their stuff ready to move into their house. That happened out here too. The McCumber Agreement was in 1892, was kind of the final. This is, and I'll talk about this because this is kind of the penultimate moment that creates the landless Indians and made, you know, the thing we had to get back to and took 156 years to do it. Is McCumber was this bureaucrat from DC who, a year before he came out, the Indian agent in the Turtle Mountains knew that Little Shell wasn't going to cooperate and sell the land that they wanted. So he rounded up 32 other men on the reservation, 16 Chippewa and 16 Métis, who for whatever reason he convinced was in their best interest to agree to whatever was coming from the United States. And they identified those 32 as the only ones who could negotiate with McCumber. So McCumber shows up in 1892, and he presents what is now called the 10 cents treaty. He wanted to buy 9 million acres at 10 cents an acre. And Little Shell knew that some land had to be negotiated. And the chunk of land that he wanted a dollar an acre. So he shows up to the meeting and he finds out he's not even allowed to speak, even though he is still the traditional leader of all of the people. And so he leaves the negotiations, the agreement gets signed, and literally just like that, all of these Indians, all of these members of the Turtle Mountains, who those 32 and the agent determined live there versus who didn't, were disenrolled and became landless Indians. So you had family split. You know, you'd have one brother who was still part of the community, but the other brother who happened to be off hunting or trading in Canada or Montana, as we'd always done, was determined as being someone who didn't live there and was not enrolled. So it was this huge land grab and very typical, you know, bad faith negotiation by the United States government. So this is a photograph of a group of Turtle Mountain, Chippewa, Métis under Little Shell from roughly that time period. So this creates what I mentioned was the Métis archipelago, because already, you know, as things were unraveling, as the bison were disappearing, you know, from the 1850s until they're finally gone, you know, by 1880, already we were starting to spread out and live on the edges of communities, trying to find ways to reinvent ourselves, because our lives as buffalo hunters and our buffalo economy was gone. So all over Montana, particularly, like Lewistown was founded in 1879 by a group of Métis family who moved down from the Milk River right before Colonel Nelson Miles burned everybody out and drove them off. But you have to remember also at this time period, everything else that's going on in central Montana and south of there. You know, you have Custer gets his ass kicked in 1876. The Nez Perce make their run in 1877, right up through this area. And, you know, in that period, there's more and more settlers coming. Sitting Bull leaves the Battle of Little Bighorn and is in Canada. And everybody is freaking out that Sitting Bull is going to raise this huge army and come and just total war across the central United States. And of course, that never happened. But the military presence was high. The threat of against Indians was so high. And we had essentially had to go underground. Here's a photograph of Hill 57, which is in Great Falls, kind of in the northwest corner, that used to be a big 57 in white rocks on the side of the hill, where we kind of was kind of a stronghold for us, where we kept our traditions alive and where other tribes would go to practice spiritual ceremonies that were illegal to practice anywhere else. But at the time, it was far enough on the shoulder of white communities that it's like, as long as you stay here and don't bother us, we won't bother you. So it became kind of this cultural stronghold for all of the tribes of the region. Cree Deportation Act of 1896 is when the United States decided they were going to round up all of the Indians who weren't on reservations, all of the what they called Canadian Indians. Typically, if you in Montana, most of the Indians that you call Cree were identified as Cree because the United States figured any Indian who they didn't consider to be from the United States was considered Cree. So there could be any number of the tribes north of the border, but they just got lumped under the name Cree. So, you know, the Buffalo soldiers under Black Jack Pershing out of Fort Assiniboine up by Haver went out and rounded up anybody they could find, put them on rail cars and shipped them to Canada. And when they ran out of money, they did it on foot. So that's kind of our Métis, our landless Indians trail of tears, because, you know, people died on the way. And the story of the time is that we would make our way back before the soldiers did. And that's how we ended up married into all of these other tribes, because we would have relationships with people who were on the Blackfeet Reservation or on the Flathead Reservation or out at Fort Peck, you know, because all of these established Montana reservations are happening in this time period also. So we just either hung out on the communities of white settlements or we interspersed with existing reservations. This is a photograph from Butte in 1890 something. And this is from Nicholas's book. And I just love, you know, you've got the wealthy dude in the top hat looking down at these poor, you know, Indian impoverished women. And that is kind of like the perfect image of how this time period where everything was going so well with the bison trade, and as settlers continued and as more of our land was taken and more of our resources were taken from us, we came impoverished, living on the fringes, however we could. And this photograph just encapsulates that. And for us getting federal recognition, you know, there were a number of things that kind of started to pick up momentum. You know, the Rocky Boy Reservation is created in 1916 of Chippewa Cree. Those are our relatives. You know, if the easiest answer for who are the Little Shell, you know, that's the couple thousand people who didn't fit on the Rocky Boy Reservation. Because at the time, that was the goal, was that all of us were going to be given this land. Not given isn't even the right word. Allowed to live on this land. And be self-determined as Indian people, but we just didn't fit. But momentum from other parts around the state, different people who were trying to make a case for us landless Indians as being legitimate members of a legitimate tribe, you know, started in the 20s, 30s, and 40s, and we pick up momentum, and then the government wouldn't have money, and then there'd be a world war, and it just you get to a point where it seemed things were going to happen and then it would fail. But by the late 1978, it was in 1978 when the United States realized that there were thousands and thousands and thousands of unrecognized Indians who were petitioning the government to allow them to be federally recognized, that they realized they needed to make a path for that to happen. So 1978 is when we actually became the Little Shell tribe and then just started gathering documents to prove who we were, who we are. And we got state recognition in 2000. And then ultimately, you know, we're one vote short in 2018 because of Utah Senator Mike Lee, but we just started over again in 2019 and sealed the deal. And the day that waiting for a day that never comes actually came when we got our federal recognition. And that's kind of, I mean, there's a bunch of stuff I didn't talk about. I feel like this was a little disjointed, but I would like to have some time for questions. And I'm more than happy to talk about some of the other things, some of this more specifics, but that's where we are.
Let's see, Chris, I'm not seeing myself. Not sure if you are seeing me and hearing me.
I'm both seeing and hearing you.
Okay, good then. Okay, that was spectacular. And I think I can speak on behalf of all of us in saying, I mean, there's so much to learn. And like you said, people just don't know. These are the things that we are certainly not taught. And it is just what a spectacular, rich presentation. And if this didn't whet everyone's appetite for your book, Becoming Little Shell, coming out, I think that the 123 people who attended tonight will be the first ones out to buy your book. Such amazing information. And there are a lot of really spectacular questions. You prompted a lot of conversation on all sorts of topics. So I'm going to kind of just roll through because there are quite a few questions from your audience.
Okay. Well, thank you, Rebecca, first for the kind words.
Ah, truly. And I'm reflecting some of the things that are being said too, but I mean, just absolutely riveting tears, all the things, you know. This is a heartbreaking story, as are the stories of colonialism. And it's a really beautiful thing to get some of this out on the table. And as you know, being involved in Swan Valley Connections, you know, we value our Indigenous neighbors, we value Indigenous traditional ecological knowledge and the value of how our cultural and natural resources are intrinsically tied. And I think you really just beautifully told that story through the perspective of the Métis. And anyway, so no, really can't thank you enough. And I look forward to many, many more presentations getting into the details. So let's get started at the top and just say, one of our audience members, Cecilia Denver, is from Lewistown, Montana, and she's wondering if you're related to the Latres from Lewistown.
Yeah, that's where I come from, is those families who founded Lewistown. So Mose Latre was part of that initial group of people who came from the Milk River Valley to Lewistown and founded Lewistown. That's my great-great-grandfather. So there's like the Reed's Fork there, which is still there. He built that. It was the first post office in central Montana. And he was hired to build that. He was a wood hawk on the Missouri River, which means he chopped wood. I mean, he did a ton of things. He's a very interesting guy. That wood hawks would pile up this lumber on the Missouri River for the steamships that would come through. And that's what he did first. And he was a undertaker. And he translated for the U.S. Army out of Lewistown. He did all kind. He was a butcher. So I like to think of his job as an undertaker and as a butcher to like the perfect overlap of knowing how to handle dead meat. So yes, I'm directly tied to the Latres of Lewistown. And that's where my dad was actually born.
Ah, so neat. That's amazing. And another connection, you know, to our staff, Mike Marinick, our Forester Conservation and Stewardship Associate, is from Lewistown. And I'm sure he'll be thrilled to know this deeper connection with you as well.
And the Donies. The Donies were part of those families too. So, you know, my grandmother was a Donie, my grandfather was a Latres. So I am directly tied on both sides to that community.
Neat. Ah, such a beautiful part of the state. So another question. Jean-Baptiste Charbonneau, who we all sort of know, born on February 11th, 1805 in Fort Mandan near what is today Washburn, North Dakota, was the son of Toussaint Charbonneau and Sacagawea. Is he considered Métis?
I would consider him that. You know, the thing we get into is, because Charbonneau definitely was. There were a number of Métis guys on the Lewis and Clark expedition. But then, and this is like the argument that is happening in Canada right now, and it's the argument that we have in the United States as far as what does it mean to be whatever the indigenous person is that you are. So, you know, you would decide, how was this guy raised? You know, did he grow up in a Métis culture? Where did his parents recognize whether they were, you know, were they sharing that they came from this Métis heritage? So that's what it is. You know, it's not a race thing. It's a culture thing. And one could argue that because I was not raised in the traditional Métis or Chippewa, I mean, my tribal ID says I'm Chippewa Cree. You can call me Chippewa, you can call me Cree, you can call me Métis, and any one of those is fine with me. But I was raised in a different type of the Métis culture. And the culture that I was raised in is the one that said, you don't tell anybody who you are because you risk death, deportation, whatever it is. So that, I think, when we talk about these identity issues as far as, well, who are you? Yes, I am Métis, even though I've never danced to a fiddle in my life, you know? So it's a difficult question to answer. I would say from the 50,000 foot level, yeah, this guy's Métis because that's where he comes from. Now, did he actually practice the culture or did he decide I'm an American? Who knows? But yes, I would say he was.
Fascinating. Right. That conversation in of itself is like is its own presentation. Mm-hmm. You know, where I came from, Southwest Montana, and being tight with the Shoshone and the mixed band of Shoshone Bannock tribes, like that never really even came up. But anyway, again, that's a whole nother conversation, but super appreciate the question and answer to that one. Just going through, some folks talked about how fabulous this was and hoping the link will be shared for those that aren't watching, just to everybody to know, yes, this is being recorded. It will be posted to Swan Valley Connections website as well as our YouTube, and everyone will be sharing it widely, also on our Facebook and Instagram. Also, some comments about the Paul Kane artworks and how incredibly gorgeous those are. And really interesting, this person shared a link in the chat, and we'll make sure that we share that too, because they seem to be great, accurate representations. Can you remind me about the time frame that he was doing those artworks?
He was there for like a dozen years. I want to say it was like mid-1830s to mid-1840s, somewhere in that time frame. I'd have to double check my notes, but yeah. There were a couple artists. The other guy who did a bunch, his name escapes me. I'd have to look that up. But we're fortunate that there were these artists that were there that were able to capture what the life looked like then.
Sort of in real time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So neat. Couple of other conversations going on about talking about how Charlie Russell was drinking buddies with their great grandpa, and grandpa, other friends, you know, other families who were friends with Charlie too, and Teddy Blue Abbott. A question: was Francis Janeaux Métis? Janeaux.
Just based on the name, I would imagine probably was. Again, it's like, this is the anecdote I always use. Like where we live, if you see a raptor on a power pole or flying overhead and you're not sure what it is, you can sound smart by saying it's a red-tailed hawk, and 80, 90% of the time you're going to be right, because that's mostly what we have out here is red-tailed hawks. When you see a French name out this way from that time period, if you say it's Métis, you're most likely going to be right, because there weren't that many actual French people here at the time. It was mostly varying degrees of Métis people who were still marrying Indigenous women. So I would, you know, just looking at the name, I would say probably.
Mm-hmm. Here's a question. How do you say little shell in your language?
Essence, which means little clam, basically. The thing well, what is our language? So our tribe, like I said, we have people who identify straight up Chippewa or Cree. I identify as Métis, and there's kind of a division. I don't mean a negative division. There are different sides of our culture, because we have a number of elders, depending on, like, if you like the community in the Teton Canyon just outside of Shota was very much Métis, and they celebrated with fiddles and jig dancing and celebrated over New Year's. But like our powwow, we have drum dancing, and our Métis elders are like, yeah, we didn't do that. So I don't really, that's not my thing. But we have, you know, we've chosen, like, our language program for the little shell is the Ojibwe language, Chippewa language. Last fluent speaker, I'm gonna start crying. Last fluent speaker of the Chippewa language in Montana died of COVID last year. So, you know, we're doing our best to restore a language for a community of people that no one really speaks. You know, we have people who can do a little bit, but as far as fluency, no. If we want to talk about midshif, I was speaking to some elders this past summer, and they figure there's about 1,000 fluent midshif speakers left in the world. And of those, more than 1,800 of them are in Canada. So that is a very, you know, I know like 3 words, you know, and I think about how my great grandparents spoke whatever it was they were speaking, which I don't even know, whether it was Chippewa or Michif or Cree. They spoke that among themselves. And it makes me think that my grandparents would have had to know it too, right? Maybe not, but 2 generations gone, removed, and it's gone from my family. And that is such a huge loss that I don't think people who have never had to consider that can understand just the gut level disconnect you feel with your ancestors when it's basically gone from your culture. Hopefully we can get it back. I'm sorry I went off on a little bit of a tangent there, but.
No, it's all part of this story, and yeah, it's crushing, and you're right. It's hard to understand, and all we can do is continue to seek to understand, right? To approach all of this with curiosity, and how can we make it better, and how can we support the return of your culture? Let's see. Do you have any examples of the Welsh influence on the language and culture, or know of any resources that you may direct people to learn more?
Well, you know, we have like a language, I think we have a language thing on YouTube. One thing to keep in mind is that for the little shell, you know, prior to 2019, we, you know, all of our tribal council members are volunteer. We had 1 paid employee, and we literally funded our operations with bake sales and raffles. And we still haven't gotten any money as a result of our federal recognition because of the bureaucracy involved in determining who's really members and just all of the red tape that the United States makes us do for that type of thing. The only reason we've made any headway at all is because our federal recognition allowed us to be in line for CARES Act money for COVID relief. And we got $25 million. And we were able to take that money and initiate projects that would have taken more than a decade to get started. So a lot of these things, culture that we want to do, it's not like we have this infrastructure in place that we just move forward with. We're building from the ground up. And a lot of that stuff, we don't really have among ourselves, let alone to share to the wider world. It's happening, but it's a slow process, especially in the middle of a global pandemic. So, you know, it's been challenging.
Interesting. Yeah, interesting timing of all of that. And so a follow-up question that someone just posted kind of to that tone. Do the Métis or the Little Shell in your case use blood quantum for tribal membership, and or how are they determining that?
We do. My hope is that when we get through this first hurdle of infrastructural implementation with the federal government, that when we look at our tribal constitution, I'm hoping that we eliminate blood quantum. We do currently. And, you know, I don't know, 6 years ago, I talked to Gerald Gray about that. And, you know, it's one of those rules that is largely impressed upon Indigenous tribes by the federal government in the long game towards eliminating tribes altogether. And we don't have to do that. And I'm hoping that we choose not to. Most tribes do use blood quantum. And, you know, that's a whole nother presentation. But you've seen me go off the rails on that before. Yes, we do, but I'm hoping it's a short period that we're going to be doing any longer.
Thanks for that. I was just going to say that actually is its own presentation that would be super interesting to host amongst, you know, all of the members on our board and our advisors, and just something that, again, I think most folks don't know about. So on to a few other questions here. Lots of thanks again. Wondering, do you think that Peter Bowen did a fair job defining Métis in his main character development of Gabriel Dupré? That is where I first heard of the Métis.
Yeah, I know of those books, and I think I have a couple, but I have not read them. So I can't say if he did or not, but I would suspect he probably did, because Peter Bowen was a great writer. So I'm hoping so, but I can't say for sure.
Another book question. What is the title of the children's book that has the map you showed?
I'd have to look it back up again. I'm sorry.
That's okay. If you come up with that answer, and perhaps at the end, we can give folks a way to get a hold of you, that sort of thing, or something that we can certainly post when we post the link to this presentation. Who is the artist on the black and white line drawing of a lone guy shooting buffalo? So this might require you to go back into your...
Yeah, I'd have to look that up too.
Okay.
If I don't write stuff on my hands, I forget it.
I'm glad it's not just me. This is from Arnie, who wanted you to know. It was from Arnie. Chris, what is the middle title word of the Paul Kane 1846 painting? The title was Half Breed Something Buffalo.
You know, I'd have to go and take a close look at that myself.
Okay. Where did the Métis get cattle that early?
St. Louis.
Where everything out west, apparently. I'm from St. Louis, and it really right. was quite a gateway, quite a melting pot, and so interesting. I've always found how interesting the parallel sort of histories of Missouri and Montana, you know, just so much coming out of there.
One of the Métis stories too in Montana related to cattle is Johnny Grant. So Johnny Grant was a Red River Métis What's that?
Oh, I just saw, of Grant's Coors Ranch.
Grant Coors Ranch, yeah. So in 1845, he goes down to Fort Hall, which is just north of Pocatello, which was the farthest southern Hudson Bay Company trading post. And it was there mostly to service people on the Oregon Trail. And Richard Grant was Johnny's father. So Johnny goes down there and starts trading worn out cattle, taking them off the hands of the people headed west, and then fattens them up and brings them up to what is the Deer Lodge Valley. So by the 1860s, he's got thousands of cattle and he's just making bank supplying mining camps and things. And the Deer Lodge Valley was a major Red River resettlement zone. But then after the Civil War, all of these people move west and they're racist as hell. And they hate Indians and they hate half-breeds. And Johnny Grant says, I've had enough of this. I'm going back to the Red River Valley. So he sells the ranch to Conrad Coors, who's his major distributor at the time. And the big house at the Grant Coors Ranch, which is a like a national historic area now, is built in the fashion of a Hudson Bay Company factor house. And Vrooman's book, and I think I stole it out of Vrooman's book for my book, Johnny Grant's journal identifies exactly how they went back. I mean, and he had, you know, thousands of horses and his men, you know, organized like in companies, like a military caravan going back, you know, east. But as they're going east, you know, people are peeling off to these other communities, you know, and that's part of how, you know, we ended up, because it's like, hey, I've got family in, you know, what's now Havre, I'm going to go up there. Or I've got family living, you know, in the Teton Canyon by Shoto, I'm going to go there. So that's part of that diaspora as well.
Fascinating. You know, for folks who haven't been, the Grant Coors Ranch is a really interesting, place to visit. Great story. And interesting talking about that whole denying your indigenous roots for a long expanse of American history, how much is lost or is maybe at the fringe edge of a story. And so interesting to put that together because that ranch and its story of cattle is really, you know, the expansion of cattle in Montana is its main story. So fascinating. Let's see. Give a shout out to your publisher of who's publishing your book.
Milkweed Editions out of Minneapolis, Minnesota.
Love them. Everyone should check out Milkweed. That was a great question. Do you have information about the Northwest Half-Breed Commission? And in this, the guest that was asking was saying that she's has bits of information on her family. And so anyway, wondering if you know about the Northwest Half-Breed Commission.
I've never heard of that.
Write it down. Something else to learn, perhaps.
Yeah.
Here's someone's asking if you know of any other tribes in Montana who are struggling to get federal recognition, and are there ways that we all can support and follow up on similar efforts?
I don't know of any in Montana. I think the larger issue right now is there are a number of tribes who are disenrolling members. So like there's a big one going on in the Pacific Northwest right now where this tribal council disenrolled, I want to say a couple hundred members. And this all comes back to that blood quantum sovereignty per capitas and how, you know, blood quantum rules are often embraced by, we probably shouldn't get into it. Blood condoms a bad thing. Federal recognition, you know, it's really hard one to get federally recognized. I think less than 20 tribes since they started doing it out of the 100, might even be only like a dozen, have actually succeeded. And it took us, we had 80,000 pages of documentation proving how we were, how we came to be, why we were who we were saying we were or are. And especially for larger tribes, and because sometimes tribes work against other tribes, it's really a complicated system, and it's a shit show. And it is really hurtful to a lot of people, beyond ways that most people, I think, understand. Because the first thing, even like when you got federal recognition, go to a Yahoo article about it, and there's some jackass, so when you're building your casino, you know, most tribes don't have casinos. And most of the tribes who do have casinos don't make any money on it. So there's all of these just garbage perspectives about what it is like to be an indigenous person in North America that are just wrong. And that's what gets frustrating.
Thank you for sharing that. And yes, in future conversations. Let's see here. You had mentioned wondering, do you know if they will be publishing Nicholas Vrooman's book again?
The tribe, our tribe, is trying to get the rights right now to republish it. Okay. And I hope it happens.
Okay, here's another question. I had heard stories that the Métis and Little Shell people retreated to the canyons, Sun, Teton, Birch, Deep Canyon on the Rocky Mountain front to avoid conflict and deportation. Is there a record of this or more information you want to share about that?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's part of it. Al Wiseman lives in Shoto. He's one of our Métis elders. He knows more than anybody alive what that Teton Canyon community was like. And he's, you know, he's 83 years old. And he takes people up there, and you can see the marks of the excavations for the root cellars under the cabins they had up there. And there's a cemetery up there that Al maintains. And yes, I mean, it was at its height, there were over 100 people living up there. And, you know, they were living there at least as early as 1860, which predates kind of the story that even the United States used. You know, I mentioned the Cree Deportation Act of 1896. There was a rebellion in Canada in 1885 called the Northwest Rebellion, led by this guy named Louis Riel. And Louis Riel remains one of the most, in fact, I think I read he's the most written about Canadian in history because of his impact. And he was the leader of two rebellions in Canada. One actually created the province of Manitoba. And as a result of that, he was exiled from Canada and actually lived in Helena and was part of the kind of the local community in Helena and was teaching at St. Peter's there when the Métis came back and said, we want to try again in Saskatchewan. Will you come lead us? And he did. And he ended up hung for sedition against a queen for a country he was no longer a citizen of because he became a naturalized American citizen. So technically that was illegal too. But, you know, the result of that rebellion is that there were a lot of refugees because the Canadians are every bit as bloodthirsty when it comes to Indigenous people as the Americans are. So don't buy any of those, oh, Canadians are so nice. They're not. Not at the federal level. And the story, like the Teton Canyon, is that, like, well, you know, these were refugees that were hiding out. Well, they were already there. And yes, some people who had relatives there went to that community after the rebellion, but they were there before then. again, it's hard sitting in this room by my, this entire presentation is almost surreal because I don't feel like I articulate very well. And I get rambling on these tangents and all of my axes to grind. And I'm sorry if I get a little out of control sometimes.
Don't apologize. The sparks from your grinding axes will just go on to be other conversations in the future. And so lots of comments here about, you know, how you're opening up perspectives that folks didn't know. Let's see, I want to come back to that question. But back to a little bit of Grant's Métis history. This guest was talking about how, you know, hadn't been to the Grant Coors Ranch since they were a kid, but it seems like it was whitewashed history. Do you know, do they talk about Grant as being Métis or anything about that?
Does who talk about that?
At the Grant Coors Ranch, do they bring in that Indigenous perspective at all? Or is it
not to my, you know, I haven't been in that. I went once when I was like in high school or junior high, mm-hmm. and it's been closed for COVID over the last 2 years that I've been wanting to get in there. The website really doesn't talk about it. And so I would be shocked if there's much mention of it.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Something else that hopefully will come to light and get added. Another question was wondering, looking for the Little Shell's historic or current association and connection with what is now known as Yellowstone National Park. Do you have any information on that or where someone could find out more?
Well, I would certainly expect that Métis adventurers ventured into Yellowstone National Park. But as far as it being any part of our kind of traditional land, no. You know, we would have been explorers just like anybody else. Doesn't mean that we weren't there or that there were Métis people who were living there, but I would never try and tie, that belongs to other Indigenous people, not us.
Great. Thank you for that. What does the clover in the Little Shell tribe seal symbolize?
So that is a connection to our, oops. Did I just do something?
Mm-mm. Nope, okay. You're still, it's like your title slide. It looks like it's on the flag.
I've got something open here I want to close so I can look at it. That is in reference to, you know, like you'll see a lot of Métis people with names like McDonald. That is just a nod to our more, you know, Welsh, Scottish, English, European heritage. You know, it's mostly French, but there are a lot of you know, Gaelic people also, you know, in our history. Just like the fleur-de-lis represents the French side.
I was just going to ask. That's and I found that your comment about that, you know, the bits of language and the fiddles and the things that went back to the Gaelic pieces, fascinating.
Mm-hmm.
Great. Let's see. So, this is an interesting question. With the federal recognition now, do the Little Shell have water rights or other natural resource rights?
Well, no, not because of federal recognition. So, when it comes to land, I mean, this is kind of a complicated question too, but like we get 200 acres, but we have to buy it. And then that land gets put in trust, like reservation land is in trust with the federal government. So unless we can find affordable land that has some kind of a resource, like if we can find where, you know, anything you might think about, you know, we are not going to have a land base that is enriching us through resources is the short answer, because mm-hmm. that's already been taken away from us. If you think of the Bakken, as horrific as that is, that's all Pemba and Chippewa land all across North Dakota. So I was driving back and I went to, for the first time ever, the Little Shell were invited to a commemoration of the Treaty of Old Crossing in 1863, which is in Minnesota. And I was part of a very small delegation of Little Shell people who went to represent us, which had never happened before. And you know, there were, it was us and the Turtle Mountain Chippewa and the Red Lake Chippewa and some Métis people from Canada who couldn't get in because of the border being closed. But the chief of the Red Lake, you know, Chippewa were saying, you know, up until like 10 years ago, I didn't even know you guys were out there. So like we were totally disconnected. Nobody knew where we were. Because all of the tribes are dealing with all of this, just trying to deal with their own issues. And for us, it was really a big deal to, for the first time, start connecting to these people that we are part of, that we're related to and have never been able to, you know, come to the table with. And that was great. So on my way back, I visited the Turtle Mountain Reservation where, you know, Little Shell is known by everybody. There's a Little Shell Street, you know. And then just driving across North Dakota on the way back and just kind of squinting and imagining what that landscape was like when there were just thousands and thousands and thousands of buffalo on it. You know, now you go through there and it's all oversized pickups and oil wells, and it sucks, you know, especially since, you know, I hate to talk about it in the terms of money, but if you want to get crass about it, we never saw a cent for any of that. And it's America, you know, that's part of that history that we don't talk about.
So many things. Let's see. Is there any history of the Little Shell moving to northeast Montana that you know of, specifically the Zortman-Lundusky area?
Oh, absolutely. Zortman, one of the greatest photographs, Métis photographs there is from a bar in Zortman of a guy playing a fiddle and a guy playing a guitar. Yeah, those are communities that we ended up in, for sure.
Neat. I'm just looking around and we'll have a couple of things. I'll want to follow up with you, Chris, to make sure that we can get the information when we post the link. But I think, because there are several questions, like this might be a great time to wrap up, and please tell everyone the name of not just your book that's coming out, but your previous published books, as well as if you could maybe talk about your workshops, your newsletter, and how to keep track of you, your work, and all of the great information that you're willing to share with us.
I could just drop a couple links in the chat if that's probably the easiest way.
You could do that. And I think it'd be great, you know, since this will be recorded perpetually. I know that Becoming Little Shell, you said it will be published by Milkweed Editions and is coming out maybe next year, not this year.
The safer bet is probably early next year, probably. I mean, it's in Milkweed's hands. I have high hopes.
And people can subscribe to your newsletter, Irritable Métis.
Yeah, and somehow, where are we? There we are. here's the link to that. I'll put it in the chat.
Okay, great. Loving that you're publishing that more often these days, and your midweek edition makes me laugh, mildly less irritable. And always good. I also want, you'll get a chance to look through these questions in the chats, and you'll see a lot of people supporting your axe grinding and your tangents. So never be afraid to be real as you are.
I just posted links to the two books I've written that really aren't specifically about this. But they're the writings of a Métis person. So that's just as important as the axe grinding, I hope.
Right. And then finally, folks need to know that you're doing some courses. In particular guest asked about, you're doing some courses talking about silence, writing, and nature. Will that include some of your Indigenous perspectives as well?
Yeah, I mean, every perspective I have is an Indigenous perspective. You know, Indigenous people are often thought that we're not being Indigenous unless we're talking about trauma or the things that are recognizable as Indigenous, like feathers and beads, you know? But that's one of the things about the Métis and like about modern Indians is that we, you know, there are some great Indigenous hip hop artists. You know, hip hop is not a traditional Indigenous practice, but it is something like anybody else. We took what worked and used it and made it our own, just like everybody does. So, you know, I happen to take a lot of old Chinese and Japanese poetry and filter it through my own perspective, which is of an Indigenous person. We don't talk about we did this. It's we do this. You know, we shouldn't talk about who we are like, well, what did you guys, you know, I'm not articulating it very well. We are still part of the modern world. We do things in the modern world like everybody else does, you know? Everybody comes from an Indigenous person, an Indigenous culture at some point in their history. We don't all cling to throwing rocks at each other though, you know?
Mm-hmm. I really appreciate you sharing that as kind of, the end of this, that it's not just history, it is living, and that you are just as, your culture is current and relevant just as much as anyone's. And so really appreciate that you ended your presentation with that reminder, and as well as the importance of learning these histories that we don't know, and how to bring those together into the present so we can move forward into the future together, I'd like to think. So Chris, with that, we will share the links, and hopefully some of the folks couldn't see that. Hopefully you're seeing that now. If not, just know we will share the links to Chris's, how you can reach Chris, the links to his books and his other endeavors, as well as the title to the children's book, some other questions. We'll try to gather all of that up and get that posted. And if you are not on Swan Valley Connections mailing list, if you are get on our mailing list, we don't send out a lot, but you can sign up at www.swanvalleyconnections.org, and we'll make sure that you get all of that information when we send out the link. We typically do that in about a week or so it takes to gather everything together. So Chris will circle back up and make sure we get all that information correct before we publish it. And for anyone who is left with us, we hope that we will see you next month on the first Wednesday of February, in which we'll be hosting a professor from UM Western, Rob Thomas, on the roadside geology of Montana, including the unique geology of the Swan Valley. And Chris, and a huge shout out to Humanities Montana, who helped to fund your time here. We are always taking donations to help fund other speakers to be here as well. Cannot thank you enough for spending your time with us tonight, Chris, and to, again, the 123 folks that showed up tonight, and the many folks that will watch afterwards. So again, thank you so much for being a part of what we do and sharing what you know with us.
Thanks for having me. Thanks, everybody who participated.
Great. Well, we will share this again, and look forward to seeing you soon, Chris. Thanks so much. Have a great night, and have a great night, everyone.
Thank you.
Take good care.